Normal, ordinary people in this country have the idea that science is embodied by experts. And if you have a degree in something, you're an expert. And if somebody else has a degree in science, he's an expert. So if two experts disagree, first of all, you don't know what to think. But you probably think that there isn't very much good science going on there because experts disagree. Well, let's talk about experts, first of all. Just because someone has a scientific degree or a degree in anything doesn't mean he's an expert. A, he's not an expert in that particular field, perhaps. B, he might not be an expert on a particular subject. C, what he knows may be out of date. It may be colored by other kinds of preconceptions or training he's had, and he doesn't really know the whole picture of things. There are lots of different kinds of experts, and that's why we don't embody science in experts. The concept of experts is an authoritarian concept. Priests, for example, are authority figures. The Pope, when he speaks ex cathedra, is held by Catholics to be infallible. Well, in science, nobody's infallible. Not Einstein, not Feynman, not Newton, not Darwin, not anyone. So it's not embodied in the people. It's embodied in the methods and how you do things and in the community of science that's reflected by all the things that we do and we publish. Now let's talk about what it means to do science. Just hanging out in a lab is not doing science. Doing science is testing hypotheses, gathering evidence, subjecting it to new kinds of analyses and synthesis, and most importantly, communicating those results in a particular way. This particular way is called peer review. Now, it's very important for people who want to understand what science is to understand the concept of peer review and why, for example, just because you publish a book that you say is about science doesn't mean that that book is important, right, or even any science at all. Why is this? Because the concept of peer review is a funny process. When you get an idea, you gather some evidence, you test your hypothesis, you get enough together that you're ready to kind of put it out to people to publish it. You send it to a scientific journal editor. You don't send it to Norton Books. You don't send it to Scribner or Knopf or any of the major publishing houses. You send it to a scientific journal because the journal editors will take your manuscript, and if they think you look like you know what you're doing to start with, they will send it out for peer review. What this means is they send this anonymously to people you don't know and you don't choose. And I mean, you may know them, but you don't know who they are. And you get almost always an anonymous peer review. The peer reviewer doesn't have to remain anonymous, but you know, mostly they do. And that peer reviewer looks at your manuscript and he looks at what you've done and what you're proposing and he says, okay, here's a proposal. Now, did this person test this in the right way? Is this an accepted method? Did he use the accepted standards of evidence? Did he gather enough evidence? Was it the right kind? Did he use good enough statistics if he had to do a statistical test of his data? Were his conclusions reasonable based on what he had? Did he go beyond? Did he speculate too much? Is this productive of new ideas and hypotheses, or is it completely unconstrained? And the reviewers will suggest perhaps several minor changes, maybe major changes, or maybe they think you're off your nut and you missed some really major things here, and you better go back from the drawing board and start again. And they will tell you exactly what they think you did wrong. Now, that's just their view. But the editor will take the view of each of these reviewers, which are independent, and he'll decide what you have to do with your manuscript, send it back to you, and then you get the decision and you go from there.